Sonny Drew, Billy Connolly, and indeed the Chieftains, and they took the name of their own group from a dole application form. 25 years after Unemployment Benefit 4.0 became UB40, they've had a string of number one hits, including I Got You, Babe, Kingston Town, Red Red Wine, One in Ten, and I Can't Help Falling in Love with You. Pretty good. As their recent autobiography reveals, those years have also seen them make and lose millions and millions of pounds, not to mention drink and drug abuse that nearly destroyed the band. They're frequent visitors to Ireland. They're playing a series of gigs here next month, in fact, but they're here tonight to talk to us. Would you please welcome the brothers from UB40, Robin and Ali Campbell.
He's my brother.
Boys,
hello, matey.
How are you?
All right.
You're settling. You look great. You haven't changed a bit since me.
I wouldn't go that far.
No, it's pretty good going. Maybe a tiny bit, but in a nice way. Welcome to our little show.
Well, thanks for having
it's
us.
Nice to have you.
It's the friendliest show I've ever been on, I think.
We're
sitting backstage, and you've come to say hello. That's the first time that's ever happened to us.
Yeah, you know, it's nice to be nice.
I was nearly moved to tears.
In fact, I saw you getting emotional, and I thought, is he okay?
Was, yeah.
In the meantime, what's the story? How did Robbie? I never put Ronnie Drew and UB40 together as such. I know that it wasn't quite a UB40 connection, but what's the Ronnie Drew connection with you boys? Of course, yeah.
We were kids, you know. But our dad was a professional folk singer, Ian Campbell Folk Group. He had a folk club in the 60s and 70s, and it was the most successful folk club in Europe at one time. So virtually everybody played that club, you know.
Paul Simon, Billy Connolly, like
Dubliners.
The Dubliners were there all the time. And they're good friends. The Chieftains, the McPeaks.
Would Ronnie Drew end up in your house as kids or something? I mean, it wouldn't
be. There's a story in the book, isn't there? Is that what you're hinting at?
Not really, because it's rude.
I came home from school once, and I was about 14 years old, and Ronnie Drew had been with me dad drinking, and as I was walking up the path to our front door, Ronnie Drew was standing there having a
he was a visitor at your dad's house, relieving himself
basically, and he thought it was the back door, but he was at the front door.
I
love him for that.
Your dad, of course, had like what, about 20 albums. I mean, your music.
He made 27, but he only sold 28. But you know, they were good albums.
So you were surrounded by music, essentially, even as kids. I mean, a lovely photograph of the two of you boys when you were little kids, which I want to show earlier. And it's really sweet. You're not that close in age, but you seem very close.
Not that far either. Isn't he? 4 years,
four and a bit years. So. Yeah. So did you look after each other or look out for each other?
Rob looked after me. Yeah, I was the baby, you know. I'm the baby of the band as well.
Yeah.
So they all look after me. Well, they're supposed to. If you read the book, they didn't really look after me that well.
But Ali, you know, when you got to the music point where you wanted to go maybe form a band and get the instruments and all that kind of thing together, just from my reading of the book, this kind of sound a bit odd, but one of the best things that ever happened to you was a punch in the face.
With a glass,
like a really ugly pint.
I was hit in the face with a pint mug when I was on my 17th birthday, actually. Earl, the bass player with us as well, we were attacked. And my older brother, David, he was a legal executive at the time, so he put in a claim for criminal injuries compensation. And 3 years after my 17th birthday, the money came through, which was $4,500 for me eye. In them days, that was a lot of money,
sure,
you know. And so we went down the pub. we got a band together.
Without that check, really, UB40 mightn't have come into existence.
Well, we wouldn't have had the catalyst.
Definitely, it was what made Ali finally say, "I'm going to start a band."
Yeah,
because I finally had some money.
At last, and because money was hard to come by. I mean, it was, you know, unemployment serious problem at the time where you were growing up, and what, you know, we were talking about the multicultural side of things and the influence.
It was a bit different for me than it was for Rob.
Why is that?
Because of the 4 or 5 years different age difference. When I left school, I couldn't get a job, you know. And I was trying to get a job for 2 years, and then the third year I didn't want a job. I formed the Climate Union instead. But it really was a one in ten, you know, when I was when I was unemployed.
And because the UB40, the name of the band, which I'm sure you're blue in the face telling people what it means, but in this country we wouldn't have had necessarily the form that you talk of, the unemployment benefit.
Yeah, well, it was a good move because we got ourselves 3 million card-carrying fans, didn't we? You know, yeah. By calling ourselves UB40, you know.
Instant hit.
It certainly wasn't a deliberate thing. It was just a mate of ours suggested us. You know, we were trying to think of names. Ali had come up with Jeff Cantor and the Nicotinis. And it was in the days of punk, you know, and almost any name would go. And a mate of ours said, "You've all got your UB40 cards." And
well, it could have been Jeff Cantor, couldn't it?
You know, imagine another life. You never know. Yeah. But I want to remind people why you guys and the band sold upwards of 50 million records in your career. And here's just a little flavour of what UB40 did and committed to record. Have a look at this, ladies and gentlemen. When you hear that, and like even the audience here singing along to every word, you really made an impact. I mean, Robin, what goes through your head when you watch that?
That you were obviously lying when you said we hadn't changed a bit.
I aim to please. But what do you think when you do? You think, God, we did it. We did all
well,
right.
Well, I constantly think that all the time. Yeah. I'm constantly pinching myself and thinking, how the hell did we get here, and how come we're still doing it now? You know?
But look at the songs, and they have such a resonance with people, and you know the real part of, you know, certainly people growing up in the 80s and the 90s and all that. It strikes me that you guys, you know, number one in the States and number one all around the place all the time, that and successful tours. One would presume you were multi-millionaires, but reading the book, you seem to just, you know, financial disaster after financial disaster after financial disaster. What happened to you?
Well, we were working class boys, you know. We were
clueless working
class. Exactly. Clueless, yeah. And something like 22 million quid went astray.
How?
Yeah. It spilt milk.
Well, that's a lovely attitude to have.
If you knew how much it really was,
he wouldn't be smiling.
Oh, God.
We started with nothing, you know, so, you know. I mean, it's...
We ain't done bad. It doesn't matter what we've lost.
No, but, Robin,
got,
you know, you bandy about a figure like 22 million going missing.
It's a lot more than that.
Is it, like, what is it, 30, 40?
A lot more than that.
Even more again?
I'm not going to say a figure.
No, well, roughly...
No, because people would just laugh.
Is it that? I mean, you're talking about a massive figure that could go up into
massive figure. We weren't registered with the performing rights societies for the first 20 years of our career, so we've received no royalties for performance.
And you just attribute that to just poor business savvy.
Well, we've successfully mismanaged ourselves for 25 years, really.
Did you just pick the wrong people to manage you? I mean, is it as simple as that?
We did, as far as the money goes, yeah.
That's
we had an accountant
who wasn't a very good accountant.
Yeah.
Well, it was a perfectly good accountant.
Nobody stole any money or anything. It wasn't claimed, you know, on our behalf. You know, you're supposed to claim it, and we didn't.
You said at one point, Ali, the irony is that I was at my saddest when I was at my richest.
I
soon discovered that people weren't too happy for me. When you were richest, you were at your saddest.
It sort of went against the grain, you know what I mean? But I remember being in Jamaica, and I had 3 million quid in my hand, tax-free. You know, I'd just been touring to make it tax-free, you know, for 2 years.
Sure.
And I'd done, certain deals. And I had £3 million and suddenly realised I didn't have any friends left, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I spent that and I got loads of mates now.
Yeah, that's fine. But Robin, when you strike me as being... I can't decide whether or not you're angry about the money that went missing all through the years. Are you angry about it, or have you made your peace with it?
Of course I'm angry about it.
And who are you angry with?
The guy that didn't register us at the beginning of our careers, you know. I mean, to only discover, after 17 years of making records, that you've received no royalties in those 17 years, performance royalties. We did receive record royalties, but not performance royalties. Yeah. To find that out is, you know, it's a very depressing thing. And, you know, you learn to live with it, otherwise you'd shoot yourself, I suppose, you know. Or shoot the guy that didn't register.
Back to him again. Ali, I know that there was a point in your career where, okay, there was booze and there was a lot of drugs going on.
That was Dublin, that was.
Yeah, I know. There was.
it's when we got to Dublin, all that started going on, you know.
But I love the time, the story you recount in the book about the time you met the guy who'd spent some time in prison with one of the Crays. I think it was Reggie Cray.
And, yeah.
Tell me what happened about that encounter.
Well, I met this guy called Pete Gillett, who'd been banged up with Reggie Cray for 7 years, and it was in my drunken days, and he produced an acoustic guitar and started singing this song, which went, "You act so macho and manly all through the day, but in the hours of darkness, you're the other way." You know. And I went, "I'll produce that for you," I said, in my drunken stupidness and me donkey's ears.
Yeah.
And so I did. I produced this record for Pete Chillerton, for Reggie Cray. Nobody had touched it with a barge pole.
But there was a moment, I think, Reggie was concerned you weren't going to do the production. He sent you a letter.
Yeah, I've got three letters. The first one is, "Thanks for looking after me, pup. God bless your friend, Reggie Cray." The middle one, because I didn't carry on doing the session, because I was working.
You tried to get out of it.
I've got the middle letter, which goes, "Remember, you kick the pup, you kick his master. God bless your friend Reggie Cray."
Don't mess with Reggie.
So I finished the record. Yeah. I put a whip on it and a gunshot and everything. And then the third one was "Thanks for looking after the pup. You know, your picture's above my bed in my cell. God bless your friend Reggie Cray."
I'm sure you're relieved to hear that.
Yeah, I've got the three letters and that's the end of that.
And of course you came to Dublin then, and I know you mentioned that things kind of went a bit funny for you over here, wasn't it?
We were at the Windmill, you know, the Windmill
Lane,
studio.
Yeah.
And, well, you know, what can I say? When we got here, it was the cocaine capital of the world, you know, and...
Dublin?
Dublin was, yeah.
Sorry, I'm not trying to be, like, complete naive, but...
No, you were a babby then.
I was, actually.
I'm sure it's all changed now, you know.
Yeah, sure.
But in them days, you know, it was down the Pink Elephant with Phil in it.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, okay.
Different times. And now you're back in Ireland again under different circumstances. And you're gigging again.
Sober as a judge and straight as a die now, you know.
Enjoying life. Yeah. And the concerts, when are they happening? Do you know offhand, or do I?
In about 5 weeks, you're all invited.
All invited. You're playing. You're playing Belfast Waterfront on November 23rd, and then down here in the Point on the 25th, and then Mill Street on the 26th. Good luck with that. Your book, incidentally, Ali and Robin Campbell's book, Blood and Fire. There it is. If you can see it there, it's in shops now. A real pleasure to meet you both, and thanks for your time this evening. Nice to see you.
Pleasure to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, man. Respect.
There you go. Okay, that's great. Earlier on.